Mic test, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, mic test, 1, 1, 1.
This committee will come to order. Today, we assess the role of civilian nuclear cooperation agreements, known as 123 agreements, or 123 agreements, as they're known by Mr. Sikorsky, especially their role in U.S. nonproliferation policy and promoting our nuclear industry abroad. Of note, the administration has recently submitted a proposed 123 agreement with Vietnam that is now under congressional review. Nuclear cooperation agreements have the dual goals of advancing U.S. nonproliferation policy and also enhancing opportunities for the U.S. nuclear industry in foreign markets. Both are of great importance, but there is an unavoidable tension between these two. Those who stress nonproliferation argue that the 123 agreements are a valuable tool in preventing the spread of uranium enrichment or the production of plutonium, also known as ENR technology, which can be used to create a nuclear weapon. Others argue that unilateral efforts to bind other countries will not work because they can turn to other nuclear suppliers, such as France or Russia, which impose virtually no restrictions. And that, of course, they argue, undermines the competitiveness of U.S. companies. Last December, the Obama administration ended its three-year review of U.S. policy on this subject, which pitted the State Department's argument for nonproliferation against the Department of Energy's advocacy for U.S. industry. The final decision was to continue to push for a no ENR commitment in nuclear cooperation agreements, but not to make that a requirement. For an administration that has held out nonproliferation as a signature issue, this is a dramatic retreat from the so-called gold standard. The gold standard policy under which countries were pressed to forgo acquiring these potentially dangerous technologies begun under the previous administration. The debate over these and other issues is reflected in the proposed 123 agreement with Vietnam. It has generated both praise and criticism. The latter focused on the absence of a binding restriction regarding ENR, its automatic renewal over 30 years, which would eliminate the congressional review that has been the norm, and Vietnam's abysmal human rights record, which we examined in committee here yesterday. This discussion is not confined to Vietnam, but to those that follow as well. We are currently in negotiations to renew our 123 agreement with our ally South Korea, which have been slowed by significant differences over ENR. Our agreement with China expires next year, and its renewal is certain to generate significant controversy. And the U.S. may begin discussions with Saudi Arabia over the massive nuclear energy program it is planning. That one is guaranteed to bring these critical issues into focus. Of course, the Obama administration has made the goal of limiting the spread of enrichment technology all the more difficult by its ongoing negotiations with Iran. In November, the administration conceded that Iran will be allowed to retain an uranium enrichment capability, a bomb-making capacity, in any final deal. That is the effective melting of the gold standard. The administration has conceded this dangerous technology to a state sponsor of terrorism that is under UN Security Council sanctions for egregious violations of its IAEA safeguards agreement. Although today's topic may sound technical, it should be clear to all that it concerns fundamental U.S. interests, not only in the present, but far into the future as well. I now turn to the ranking member, Mr. Brad Sherman, for any remarks he may wish to give.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you for holding this hearing. You and I worked for so many years as chairman and ranking member of the Terrorism, Nonproliferation, and Trade Subcommittee. We had hearing 6 years ago entitled Saving the NPT in the Area of the Nuclear Renaissance. We've had various other hearings, as you know, on the issues we now confront today at the full committee level, and they are certainly worthy of discussion at the full committee level. In addition to the focus we had 6 years ago, we've seen Fukushima, but that disaster has not prevented many countries from looking at expanding or initiating a nuclear power program. Civil programs can provide countries with the know-how, of course, to move toward a nuclear weapon. They can also provide electricity without the generation of greenhouse gases. And a number of countries will be attracted to this, not only in a cost per kilowatt basis, but also as part of any economic, where there are economic incentives to reduce their carbon footprint, nuclear power will be particularly attractive. Civil and nuclear programs may also provide cover for countries to pursue military programs. That's obvious. The means and the excuse to conduct activities related to a military program will be present in civil nuclear programs, allowing countries to pursue weapons under the guise of a civilian program. It is a particularly weak excuse to say that a country wants to generate electricity if that country has or is contiguous with other countries which have natural gas which cannot be easily exported. The cost of liquefaction, transportation, and regasification of natural gas means that it is perhaps one-third the cost on the in the area in which it's obtained than it is shipped to distant continents. Countries that have virtually free natural gas, that have no other way to exploit it, like Iran, who say that they need nuclear power for electricity, should come under special scrutiny. It is not a theoretical concern to say that a civilian program can cover for a military program. This is exactly what Iran is doing. India, which I want to point out, did not sign the NPT and therefore was not bound by any treaty not to develop nuclear weapons. But in any case, India derived the fuel used from a civilian reactor for the fissile material used in its first weapons. That's why the so-called 1-2-3 agreements, including the Vietnam Agreement, which is now sitting before Congress, need to be deliberated more than is the current practice. The current law puts Congress not in the driver's seat, not as a co-equal branch of government, not in the back seat, but in the trunk when it comes to deciding what our policy will be on nuclear cooperation agreements. These agreements come to Congress for a 90-day review. In order to stop them, both houses of Congress have to act within 90 days, something that in this Congress is unlikely to occur on a motherhood resolution. But even if both houses of Congress vote to stop such a an agreement, it goes before the president for a possible veto, and if the president vetoes the agreement, vetoes the resolution, both houses have to override with a two-thirds vote. I think that that is an affront to the doctrines that underlie the first article of the U.S. Constitution. It is not meaningful review. I'm not saying that Congress needs to have an affirmative vote on every agreement. Congresswoman Ross Layton and I have introduced legislation, H.R. 3766, which would provide that Congress would have to affirmatively vote on an agreement unless that agreement met what I call the gold standard plus. That is to say, it would have to have gold standard provisions dealing with a commitment by the country not to deploy enrichment and reprocessing, the two most proliferation dangerous technologies needed to produce a bomb-grade material, and also agree to enhanced inspections and verification regimes known as the additional protocol. In addition, they would have to allow the American companies to compete by having liability provisions No company will build a nuclear reactor without some liability protection. But Russia and France, their companies are state-owned, and so they claim sovereign immunity as their liability protection. Any 1-2-3 agreement that does not insist on liability protection for American companies basically is an agreement designed to cede the jobs, or which would have the effect, if not the design, of ceding the jobs to Russia and France. I believe that a reasonable compromise with the executive branch and industry might be available. And thank the chair for his time, and I especially thank the gentlelady from Florida for her work on the bill that I've just cited. I yield back.
We go now to Judge Poe, chair of the Subcommittee on Terrorism, Nonproliferation, and Trade, for 2 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The Taiwan 1-2-3 agreement seems on the surface to be an easy decision. Taiwan's a strong ally of the United States. Taiwan has a great democracy that shares values of the United States as well. In the agreement, there's legally binding language that Taiwan will not acquire enrichment or reprocessing technology. This is important because such technology can very easily lead to the development of a nuclear bomb. The proposed Vietnam 1-2-3 agreement is the one I have concern with. First, there's no legal binding language like the Taiwan agreement that states that Vietnam will not acquire enrichment and reprocessing technology. Vietnam is not the ally that Taiwan is, and it's ironic that we have stricter language in our deal with a close democratic ally than we do with a deal with a communist country that has really proven not to be trustworthy. However, it's also correct the United States does not control the nuclear energy market like it did in the past, and that each of these deals is important to the United States industry and American jobs. We're not in the 1950s anymore. Russia, China, France, South Korea, and Japan would be happy to take our business in Vietnam if we just walk away from some type of agreement because Vietnam does not agree to forego enrichment and the pre-processing technology. The deals they strike will probably lead to greater proliferation risk than the current situation on the table before us. I do want to hear from the witnesses what they think about this situation. Second, the proliferation risk is not the only problem we have with Vietnam. Over the last few years, human rights abuses by the governor of Vietnam have gotten worse. Pastor Cai has been detained and arrested by the Vietnam police 13 times. His crime, he's a Christian pastor who organizes prayer meetings. Such abuses continue in Vietnam. There are 100 stories like Pastor Cai, and Congress should think twice before it rewards Vietnam with nuclear energy situation when it abuses and tortures and kills its own people. Human rights really do matter, and I'll yield back.
Thank you, Mr. Poe. We are joined this morning by a distinguished group of experts. Mr. Henry Sokolsky is the Executive Director of the Nonproliferation Policy Education Center. He previously served as the Deputy for Nonproliferation Policy in the Department of Defense from 1989 to 1993. Hammer and Hank, as we know him in the office, also worked in the office of the Secretary of Defense's Office of Net Assessment. It is his birthday, so congratulations, Henry, and I'm going to assume it's your wife, Amanda, who's keeping you young. Mr. Daniel Lipman is the Executive Director for Supplier Programs at the Nuclear Energy Institute. Formerly, he was Senior Vice President of Operations Support for Westinghouse Electric Company. Mr. Leonard Spector, Sandy Spector, as he's known, is Deputy Director of the James Martin Center for Nonproliferation Studies at the Monterey Institute of International Studies, and previously he served as Assistant Deputy Administrator for Arms Control and Nonproliferation at the U.S. Nuclear Security Administration, where his portfolio included overseeing nuclear export control activities. Without objection, the witness's full prepared statements will be made part of the record. Members are going to have 5 calendar days to submit any statements or questions or extraneous material for the record. And Mr. Sokolsky, if you would please summarize your remarks to 5 minutes for each of the members of the panel here, and then we'll go to questions.
Mr. Royce, Mr. Engel, members of the committee, I want to thank you for this important hearing. Before I begin, I would ask permission that not only my full testimony, but several brief items be placed in the record. Mr. Chairman, when I last appeared before this committee, it was considering legislation that would have significantly strengthened the role of Congress in approving U.S. nuclear cooperative agreements. The committee unanimously approved this legislation, but after industry objected, it never went to the floor. That was 3 years ago. Congress now, as we've just heard, really does not have much of a hand in shaping nuclear cooperative agreements. It can continue to let the executive send up more agreements and allow them to come into force, but if Congress does, it will leave itself powerless to deal with three issues. First, possible unilateral executive authorization of Chinese reprocessing of hundreds, I repeat, hundreds of bombs worth of plutonium each year from spent fuel processed in U.S.-designed reactors. China recently announced it will buy a so-called peaceful reprocessing plant from France and locate it at China's original weapons plutonium production site. This will obviously have military significance. Under the current U.S.-China nuclear agreement, the executive can authorize China to reprocess materials from eight U.S.-designed reactors that will be operating in China. Congress has no say. This understanding expires December 2015 and must be renegotiated. Does Congress not want to have any say in this? Under the committee's stalled 2011 legislation, each Chinese reprocessing request would require congressional approval. I would urge the committee to reconsider that 2011 bill by marking up identical Ross-Layton-Brad Sherman legislation, H.R. 3766. Second, the elimination of periodic required reviews of nuclear agreements. Most nuclear agreements in the U.S. nuclear agreements are for a fixed term and must be renegotiated. The Vietnam nuclear deal, however, stays in force in perpetuity unless one of the parties asks and succeeds in getting it renegotiated. The executive is sure to push this approach in future deals until all U.S. 123 agreements automatically renew without presentment to Congress. Again, this will occur unless Congress acts to limit the practice. Given the Vietnam deal is hardly urgent, it would be best to have the executive withdraw it until this is fixed. Third, the executive is creating precedents that will make it virtually impossible to resist Saudi, Turkish, and South Korean calls to reprocess or enrich. The executive is negotiating with Iran, South Korea over enrichment and reprocessing. The Vietnam deal, a kind of mini Indian nuclear deal that undermines the gold standard on proliferation conditions contained in the UAE and Taiwanese agreements, sets a poor precedent on both fronts. Unless Congress overrules industry's current veto on legislating on these matters, expect more hand-wringing, nail-biting, Iran-like crises to emerge. Two additional notes. Industry and the State Department argue that if Congress votes on agreements that don't meet tough nonproliferation conditions, the agreements are dead on arrival, with a loss of U.S. business and jobs. But in pushing for lowest common denominator agreements, state has its priorities backwards, I would argue. Our government should be trying to convince other suppliers to raise their nonproliferation standards, which I might add are all too similar to our own, but like our own, too low. The U.S. can do this, but it needs to take the initiative. Finally, although it's hardly sound to give up important security positions because of promised jobs, it is ridiculous to do so when such promises are hugely exaggerated. India, we were told, was a $100 billion nuclear market for the U.S. 9 years after that deal was announced, though, no U.S. reactors have been sold. Yet by exempting India from restrictive NPT rules, we did great harm to that treaty and to our nonproliferation efforts globally. The GAO recently noted that the U.S. doesn't track Americans' actual nuclear exports. The committee should look into this and demand real numbers on exports of 123 controlled goods. On these matters, Congress should not be sold a bill of goods. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Lippin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, Ranking Member Sherman, distinguished members Happy birthday, Henry. I've been in this business now 4 decades, and never before in 4 decades have I seen our industry so heavily dependent and engaged in the global nuclear market. I know you may know that we are building new plants here in the United States, in Tennessee, in South Carolina, and in Georgia, but that's 5 plants. There are more than 67 plants currently under construction, all of which are outside the United States. So this is a heavily global market. Participation in this market can have significant impact in advancing a number of U.S. interests. As Henry mentioned, there certainly is job creation. We know from exports to China that close to 20,000 jobs have been created in about 15 states simply from that export. But for me as a nuclear professional, the thing I worry about and I wake up worrying about in the morning is nuclear safety. In the post-Fukushima world, I think Mr. Sherman referenced, nuclear safety certainly is a national security issue. And it's my view that American technology, particularly the latest reactor designs currently on offer in the market, offer significant nuclear safety benefits along with the operating processes and procedures that come with it. Our technology, and by the way, our regulator, with whom the industry does not always have a friendly relationship, is certainly the envy of the world. A third area of U.S. interest, which has been touched upon and will be a theme today, is that U.S. participation in markets outside the United States advances our nonproliferation objectives. We have the strongest nonproliferation controls in our civil nuclear cooperation agreements than any other country. One question here, then, is where this market is outside the United States, are we better off with America engaged in it or not? Do we make the world's nuclear operating fleets safer and more proliferation resistant if we participate or if we don't participate? And by the way, as was indicated earlier, this market is not ripe for the taking by U.S. companies. There is a lot of international competition out there, and that was referenced earlier. If we aren't going to be in these markets, I assure you our competitors will, and they are. So what do we need? What are the issues here as far as the industry is concerned? First, I think you would look at this as a handful of policy tools and issues of importance to us. 123 agreements, of course, and we'll talk about that today, but we also need an efficient, predictable, and reliable export control process that's currently managed out of the Department of Energy. Other countries have to agree to, and this was mentioned earlier, to nuclear liability regimes that protect companies from undue harm. And lastly, and I know this is, or next, and this is somewhat politically sensitive, these exports require trade finance. And reauthorization of the Export-Import Bank is something our industry strongly supports. We also need better federal coordination within the federal bureaucracy, and significant progress in the last couple of years has made that better, in our opinion, with the appointment of someone in the White House. But she's only one person. And finally, these deals are big, and they need advocacy at the highest levels of government. The China deal would not have happened had the previous administration not been personally engaged. And finally, we know that the geostrategic situation where Russia is engaged in the Ukraine and in Crimea underlines the importance of energy in this competitive world. Nuclear energy has its part. Nuclear energy plays an important role not only in electrification, but as part of U.S. policy, U.S. foreign policy, just as are digital industries, aerospace, oil and gas, and other industries. So with that, I thank you for the opportunity to testify, Chairman, and I look forward to responding to questions.
Thank you, Mr. Lippman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Chairman, before the speaker speaks,
Yes.
I just wanted to say to especially my colleague from Florida, Sandy Spector and I go way back. We worked in the Senate together when I worked, you may not know, for the Senate Foreign Relations Committee. I know that. So I welcome you, Sandy, back to Congress.
And Jerry gave him the nickname, so it's, but it's good. Mr. Spector, we will go to you.
Good. Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman, other members of the committee, and ranking member Sherman. I want to concentrate on the Vietnam Agreement, looking at several of the issues that have already been mentioned. As a matter of policy, I have strongly supported U.S. efforts for many years to discourage the development of foreign enrichment and reprocessing capabilities. Given the desire of many states to sign a nuclear cooperation agreement with us for the mark of approval, the seal of approval that it gives, these agreements provide the opportunity to negotiate restrictions on the development of enrichment and reprocessing with partner countries. The 2009 agreement with the UAE, of course, is considered ideal in its terms because it gave a blanket renunciation of any reprocessing or enrichment on its territory in perpetuity, certainly for the duration of our agreement. But we have a lesser kind of undertaking with Vietnam at this point. The language in the agreement is really in the opening section, the preamble, which is not a binding part of the agreement, it is just hortatory and descriptive. It refers back to a memorandum of understanding between the United States and Vietnam, in which Vietnam agreed that it was not its intention to reprocess or enrich, and that it was its intention to use international fuel cycle services to support its program, which are very good statements, but these are non-binding. And, of course, they are reflective of an intention. So we are a long way away from the gold standard of the UAE agreement or the Taiwan agreement. On the other hand, we have something. We do have the memo of a memorandum of understanding. We do have the reference to it in the agreement. And when you compare that to where we were historically in all of our other agreements, this is a real step forward. Other agreements only covered the enriching or reprocessing of American-provided or American material created with American exports, reactors, or fuel. The Vietnam Agreement speaks to a much broader limitation, which would cover all fuel, irrespective of what country it might have come from, all reactors, and so forth. So in that sense, it's a very positive step forward. But to reiterate, a very big step short of what we may have hoped for. Nonetheless, when you take together the partial standard here, the what might be called the silver standard, as a colleague of mine, Miles Pomper, has characterized it, and you couple that with a pretty decent record by the Vietnamese on the non-proliferation front in terms of the agreements that it has signed, the treaties that it signed, in terms of its absence, as far as I can tell, from involvement in the Iranian program. It is not usually linked, I have not seen it linked, with any of the illicit trade that is supporting the Iranian program. In general terms, the program in Vietnam is so early in its development that there are many, many years ahead before they could possibly advance to a stage that we might be concerned about. And so I would say the silver standard is a satisfactory and acceptable approach in this context on this particular matter in the agreement. It's not ideal, but it does give us something to work with. And I think it's a reflection that the Vietnamese recognize that to enrich or reprocess really at any time in the future would be a politically charged development that would raise national security concerns in many quarters. And I think that shadow is very positive. Additional protocol, they have one, so that's not an issue. What we need to look at, however, is the 5-year automatic extensions. When you couple that automatic extension with the lack of the gold standard on enrichment and reprocessing, it basically means that if their intentions change over the course of the next 30 years, we really have no way to come back to them and demand sort of a renegotiation or to demand changes in their behavior. The automatic extension deprives the Congress and the United States more generally of a ready approach to deal with some of these questions. Rather, we would have to take the extraordinary step of declaring an agreement to be terminated, which I think we would always be very reluctant to do because of the implication it would cast on our partner country. At the conclusion of my remarks, I note a number of regulatory issues, questions about the independence and effectiveness of safety regulation in Vietnam, questions about the independence of regulators because of the nature of the Vietnamese government as a dictatorship, and also the question of the lack of strategic trade controls, which basically means Vietnam does not have the ability to comply with crucial UN Security Council resolutions. Thank you very much for the opportunity to testify.
Thank you, Mr. Spector. We've been joined by the ranking member. He was at a briefing on Iran this morning. But at this time, I think it would be perfectly appropriate if he would like to make his opening statement. Mr. Elliot Engel of New York.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you for holding this very timely hearing. I want to thank the witnesses for their testimony, and I look forward to their answering our questions. This is interplay, obviously, between two crucial issues, the fight against the proliferation of nuclear weapons and the increasing global cooperation on civilian nuclear energy. We face a challenge today, a challenging question. How can we achieve our non-proliferation goals while commercial nuclear energy technology is now readily available in the global marketplace? In recent years, the U.S. has selectively pursued the so-called gold standard, a legally binding pledge by countries receiving U.S. civilian nuclear technology that they will not pursue a domestic enrichment or reprocessing capability. This provision was included in the Nuclear Cooperation Agreement with the UAE. But France and Russia, our main competitors in the global market for civilian nuclear technology, do not require no enrichment stipulations from their customers. Countries that purchase technology from these nations are free to operate enrichment facilities that might be used to produce low or medium enriched uranium for power plants or research reactors. But this technology obviously could also produce weapons-grade material. The U.S. now faces some difficult choices. We want to prevent the further spread of sensitive enrichment and reprocessing technologies, but if we continue to insist on no enrichment requirements, other governments are more likely to look to France or Russia to supply essentially the same nuclear technology. So it's a lose-lose scenario. American companies won't get the projects, and the U.S. government will have far less visibility into the nuclear programs of other nations. The stakes are enormous. Today, 434 civilian nuclear power reactors are operating in 29 countries, 73 are under construction, 172 reactors are on order or planned, and 309 more have been proposed, and these figures don't include the hundreds of reactors for research, medical isotope production, or other civilian applications. The U.S. cannot be left on the sidelines as more countries enter the nuclear marketplace. In a perfect world, I'd want all of our nuclear cooperation agreements to include the gold standard, but in practice, such a policy would isolate the U.S. and give a clear advantage to our competitors. We're dealing with a paradox. To continue fighting nuclear proliferation, we need to be flexible in negotiating our civilian nuclear cooperation agreements. This approach is reflected in the Nuclear Cooperation Agreement with Vietnam, which I support. That agreement stipulates that Vietnam will purchase nuclear fuel from the commercial market, but it does not include a formal commitment to forego enrichment or reprocessing in the future. So I hope in our questions to our distinguished panel, they can help us work through the policy dilemmas of nuclear cooperation. And I thank you, Mr. Chairman, for holding this hearing.
Thank you, Mr. Engel. I'll go now to my questions, and I'll start with my first from Mr. Sikorsky. The Obama administration recently concluded the three-year review of its policy regarding nuclear cooperation agreements. The decision was to not require other countries to forego acquiring an ENR capability as a condition, as you know, as we're discussing, for nuclear cooperation. This standard, which was included in the 123 agreements with the UAE and with Taiwan, is known as the gold standard. So is the gold standard dead? And the administration agreed up front in its negotiations with Iran that Iran would be able to continue to enrich uranium. How can this dangerous technology be conceded to a state sponsor of terrorism?
I guess the short answer is the fat lady is not yet on the stage. We have not finished negotiating with Iran. It could come up a cropper. We could be holding hearings for another 3 years talking about that deal, which may not be finished.
As Elliot shared with me this morning, we could be passing the Royce Engel bill
okay.
out of the Senate.
So that's point one.
Yeah.
Point two is saying you want to go case by case is a very expensive, long, drawn-out way of saying we don't know what to do. Now, you should demand more of our government than that. That's no policy at all. Finally, very important point. The hard yards are ahead of us. Vietnam, you know, in the short run, heck, they're not even building their first Russian reactor. They're not even going to start for another 6 years. So that's easy to kind of avert your gaze for the short term. Saudi Arabia, South Korea, does Japan start reprocessing? What does that do with China? Those things are going to keep you up at night. And I don't see any way around pushing the button for a standard because the suppliers currently pretty much have the same standards. It's just they're very loose. They're like ours. If we don't up the ante and push on the other suppliers to raise theirs,
well, let me
know
get
where
to
we're
that,
headed.
Let me get to that question then. And for you and other members of the panel, this will be my final question. Russia constructed and is supplying the fuel, the Bashir reactor. That's concerning, but so is the fact that they're talking about building eight more, right? Eight more facilities, even though Iran almost certainly has a clandestine nuclear weapons program. So why don't other supplying countries, such as Russia or France, impose similar conditions in their nuclear cooperation agreements? Don't they think that preventing the spread of ENR is important? Let's discuss that. Has the U.S. attempted to persuade other countries to adopt these restrictions? I mean, what have we done in that dialogue? And if not, why haven't we? Has it succeeded at all where we've tried? What leverage do we have on those countries? And then lastly, how significant is the negative impact on the competitiveness of U.S. companies that imposing this requirement in 123 agreements may cause? Are there specific examples that you can point to? So if I could hear from the panel on my questions there. Henry?
Yeah, I think the leverage point right now is ironically the safety point that was raised by the witness from NEI. The French are very upset with the shabby construction of their reactors in China and are afraid it's going to ruin their brand. By the way, this should be a concern for Westinghouse as well. They have not spoken up. They need to. If you do, this is a lever as you go into renewing the agreement because they do need help on more safety work. And we need to be doubling down. If there's to be a future for nuclear power designs that are American, they better not blow up. We can work with the French on this. The same thing can be done with the Russians. Why? We've suspended nuclear cooperation with them. We don't talk candidly enough about the Russian safety problem. This committee, other committees, ought to press to get our agencies to start talking about that
problem. Restart the...
Well, not restart. Get our agencies to be as candid as the French are about how poor the safety standards of places like China and Russia are. I think if we had more publicity on that, their product line would not be doing as well. You're not going to compete against those countries on price point or financing, even with EXIM. So you're going to have to push to be more candid about what their safety problems are. Then you have leverage.
And how could we get that into the record of this committee here? How could we surface that information?
Hold a hearing. It's the old way. It works.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Lippman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Let me address the latter part of your question first. It's really the area of my competence. I do not think there is a lot of leverage. I think insofar as governments, and particularly their state-owned enterprises, go out into the marketplace and pursue opportunities There are widely differing standards. In the case of the French in particular, they have a commercial fuel reprocessing business and an enrichment business, and they push that. We don't do that in the United States. Our American companies are not involved in fuel cycle activities. And I think the impact, and to be very, very clear, the industry is not against the gold standard. The industry is against universal application of one-size-fits-all policy. That's what our problem is. And when there is a universal application of a standard, when countries operate in different regions, they have varying areas of expertise, as Henry noted, in their nuclear power programs domestically. A one-size-fits-all policy is just not workable, and it excludes American companies from providing the technology that I think Henry was referring to that would better serve U.S. interests.
I'm out of time. I think I better go to Mr. Engel. Sandy, if I could, let me just defer to the ranking member.
Yeah. Good. Okay. Mr. Spector, let me ask you. In my opening statement, I laid out what I see as the central dilemma for the United States. If we insist on a no enrichment requirement, there are two consequences. We don't have good visibility into a country's nuclear program, and our nuclear companies lose market share and become less viable commercially. Do you agree that this is a problem and the main problem?
Well, it is certainly a drawback to trying to pursue this very...
Can you push the microphone down a little closer to you? Yeah.
It's certainly a drawback as we try to advance the gold standard, which we must do. This set of arguments has a familiar ring. If one goes back to the current law, which I guess I was involved in drafting, the same argument was made that it would be dangerous, and especially for American commercial interests, to insist that every state have full-scope safeguards. That is, that it place all of its nuclear facilities and equipment under International Atomic Energy Agency inspection. Nobody had that rule at the time. By 1992, all suppliers had adopted the rule, and along the way, we had many other states that supported it, Canada, Sweden, and others. We're in the same mode now. We know what we want to do. We would like to suppress enrichment and reprocessing to the maximum extent. We have a mechanism for doing that. And we have to confront the commercial negativity in some respects. But it's worth appreciating that there are only six principal reactor vendors around the world, that are really competing with each other. We have controls over our own and probably over the Japanese, since they're in partnership. The French and the Russians stand to benefit from this rule because it would drive partner states into using fuel cycle services, which they are very prominent in. And so they have a self-interest in maybe supporting a rule like this if we can really press for it. Canada, I'd say, is in a different, is a friend of the United States, I think would go along. And I think we could actually make some progress if we did a head-to-head set of negotiations to try to make this the rule. So I do appreciate the points that have been made about the challenges that we might have, but I think the goal is worthwhile, and I think we can probably make progress if we really press the point forward.
So as a practical matter, do any of you see countries accepting a no enrichment requirement in the future in order to obtain civilian nuclear technology, and for countries that refuse to agree to no enrichment and are likely to build civilian reactors, are there any countries that you see as proliferation risks? Mr. Sikorsky?
Look, part of our problem is we try to predict what's going to happen 30 years in advance, and we get it wrong over and over again. So let's just be democratic here and say almost any country that's not a mutual security pact ally of the United States could possibly cause problems. I'll go further. You know, if South Korea gets nuclear weapons, it's a problem even though it is an ally. It is very, very hard to know which country is going to be a problem. Vietnam, 30 years from now, could very well be a problem. Certainly, we didn't think that Iran was going to have nuclear weapons 30 years ago. So I think the first point is they're all problems. That's the reason why you need a single rule. Second of all, I think voting on agreements is a little different than demanding that all agreements be exactly the same. I think if we are unwilling to use the deliberative body to debate and analyze what's correct, then we've given up on self-government over this issue set, and you should just send it back to the executive and say it's their fault if anything goes wrong.
Mr. Lippman, let me ask you this. There are 172 reactors that are planned to be built, and can you tell us the competitive position of our U.S. companies, which are mainly Westinghouse and GE? And I want to also ask you about the China nuclear market. They have 57 reactors planned and another 118 in the proposed stages. So could you tell us what the state of play is in that market? Where do the U.S. companies stand with that?
Yes, Ranking Member. Let me start with the first part of your question on competition. Sandy's count was six. There are about 10 nuclear reactor vendors out there because in the last few years we've seen the rise of Korean competition, more Russian competition. There are three Japanese vendors as well as Areva. And by the way, the Chinese are not far behind, to answer part of the second question. They will be in the export market, sir. So the bottom line is it is a very competitive market out there. Each of these competitors brings different tools, different levels of state sponsorship, and different ancillary deals, be it military or other sorts of commercial concessions to the party. So it is very competitive. There is not U.S. dominance. GE and Westinghouse, however, have indicated that they can win against these competitors. The win in China in 2007, and I'll segue my answer to the second part of your question, Ranking Member, was a win against the Russians and the French. So we can win, we can compete, and we can win, but only if there is a level playing field. We're Americans, we like to compete, but we want a level playing field. As to the Chinese program, sir, I lived in China for 4 years, and I can tell you that the environmental situation in China is such, it's only gotten worse since I've lived there. Like the United States, the population is largely in the east, and coal is in the north and in the west. A lot of the rail stock is used to transport coal. So they're going very heavily into nuclear technology. The first tranche of units that they bought were a little bit from here, a little bit from there. And then they settled on Westinghouse AP1000 technology as the basis, but not the sole basis, for their program going forward. It is my understanding that the second set of reactors is currently up for bid. That will be negotiated sole source with Westinghouse. And so it gets to the point, frankly, that my colleague Henry made, which is, yes, this is, you have to look forward 30 years. That is exactly why you want American technology in there. Because when you're in, and especially when you're in the beginning, you get follow-on work, you have participation in the nuclear program, and you have a view of what's going on in the country. My view at the time when I was negotiating the China contract, sir, was if we don't win, we're on the outside looking in for decades. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
We better go to Eliana Ross-Leitanen, Chairwoman of the Middle East Subcommittee.
Thank you so much, Mr. Chairman. Thank you for this hearing, and thank you to our witnesses. Throughout the past 6 months, there has been much discussion here in Congress about the role of this legislative body regarding nuclear agreements. The Obama administration's misguided policy toward Iran is a game changer, could potentially spark an arms race in the countries in the world's most unstable and dangerous region already. I disagree with the administration's insistence on taking our 1-2-3 agreements on a case-by-case approach rather than holding each country equally to the gold standard. Why are we holding countries in the Middle East to different standards than in Europe or in Asia? We should be holding each country to the very strictest of standards to ensure that maximum safeguards are in place. If Congress has the ability to vote up or down on a free trade agreement, why not on a nuclear agreement? That is why earlier this year I reintroduced, alongside with my colleague Brad Sherman, H.R. 3766, which reforms the Atomic Energy Act of 1954 to provide greater congressional oversight of nuclear agreements with foreign countries and protect against the threat of nuclear proliferation. Let's not forget about the U.S.-Russia Nuclear Cooperation Agreement, which was previously withdrawn by the Bush administration in 2008. Why? Because the president could not certify under the Iran, North Korea, and Syria Nonproliferation Act that Russia was not providing nuclear missile and advanced conventional weapons to Iran. This is important to note because we cannot examine these agreements in a vacuum. When these 123 agreements are proposed, we must take into account our foreign policy and national security interests, as well as a country's human rights record, and we must hold each and every country to those same standards that we set, which brings us to the 123 proposed agreement with Vietnam. I strongly oppose this agreement. Allowing Vietnam to enrich undermines our objectives in other areas in the Middle East, where allies such as the UAE and Jordan are held to the gold standard. Vietnam has an abysmal human rights record. The practice of human trafficking is rampant, and there are severe restrictions against religious freedom. Congress must be empowered in its oversight responsibility, and we must ensure that such agreements not only protect our interests, but help guard against the rising threat of nuclear proliferation. When Brad and I introduced the bill, NEI immediately opposed it, stating that the bill risks national security and that it will cost U.S. jobs. Some of these same claims were made about the Colombia Free Trade Agreement, which was initially signed in 2006, that if we didn't sign immediately, we would lose U.S. jobs. But after 5 years of congressional input and enhancement to approve the agreement, the cost of the idea of costing jobs did not prevent Congress from making the bill better, because in the end, expediency is not the objective. The objective is to create an agreement in which the U.S. benefits, and in the case of a nuclear agreement, U.S. national security should be the first priority. Then there's the claim that the bill would undermine U.S. national security because we will lack a commercial presence on the ground. But that did not do us any good in Russia. We have a 123 agreement with Russia, which I opposed, but that hasn't stopped the Russians from supporting and providing sensitive materials and technology to the Iranian and Syrian regimes. And finally, there is the narrative that the U.S. would lose commercial business, that these countries will go turn to other nations to fulfill their nuclear needs. Well, let's take a look at our foreign policy, our foreign military sales program. It might take some time to get through the process, that's true, but our military technology and equipment is the best. And these countries that follow the process that we have in place because they know that they are getting the best quality when they buy from us. The same can be said about our nuclear know-how. Nuclear technology is not something you want to cut corners on. You want the best. I believe that these countries will stay with American companies because they know what they can get from us. Congress should already have oversight responsibility over these sensitive agreements. Congress must have a final say in any agreement that includes enrichment, and we must be able to have an up and down vote. Mr. Chairman, when Congress will finally have a say over these nuclear agreements, we will ask, why hadn't we always done so? It makes common sense. It makes perfect sense. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for allowing me to make my statement.
Well, we thank you very much. And Eliana, we will go now to Mr. Brad Sherman, who's the ranking member on the Terrorism and Nonproliferation Subcommittee.
In further support of our bill, Ms. Ross-Layton, I'll point out that Congress has demonstrated the ability to vote on and pass nuclear cooperation agreements with both India and the renewal of the Korea 123 agreement. And I'd point out that our bill, I think, is probably an industry's interest, though they may not focus on this, because it says if you don't want to vote in, have to have a up or down vote in Congress, you need a standard that has adequate liability protection for our companies. And I've been very disappointed with the Indian deal, where because for a number of factors, but especially the fact that India has not given us adequate liability protection, we haven't built a single reactor there, or even started one. Now, Mr. Sokolsky, we've got a proposal for a French-built plant for the production of weapons-grade uranium derived from spent fuel from U.S. origin reactors. How many bombs does China have now, and how many more could they create in the next 10 years just from this reprocessing plant? Plutonium, excuse me.
The problem is we don't know how many weapons they have. The respected opinions of most analysts, and I think our government, is that they have no more than perhaps 200, maybe 300 weapons.
If this French plant were built over the next 10 years, it would provide plutonium sufficient for?
Well, if you have 8 reactors of the AP size, which is about 1,100 megawatts, it will produce 1,600 kilograms of weapons-usable plutonium. Mm-hmm. That plutonium, you divide by 4, that's the DOE number, so that's 400 bombs per year. Now,
400 bombs per year?
Worth, yes. Worth. Now, that's assuming you use crude bomb design.
We're talking about them deriving enough plutonium every year to create as many bombs as they currently have in stock.
Well, here's the good news. The Chinese actually are pretty savvy. They don't like wasting money unnecessarily. Mm-hmm. They are haggling over price. They are looking at the Japanese and the South Koreans and what others are doing. If they don't see them reprocess, watch this program slip. We should be leaning on everyone in that region to not recycle, including the Chinese, mm-hmm. and avoid this uncertainty. Now, many people will say, oh, well, it's not weapons grade and this and that. In private, I can lay out sort of the design things that we've learned from the labs that make it very clear this stuff is very usable, very usable for weapons. And so it's something you do not want to encourage.
What does China think of us having a nuclear cooperation agreement with Vietnam? And can we cooperate with China on nonproliferation policy or nuclear policy, both with an eye toward the fact that their own 123 agreement needs to be renewed in 2015, and they may want to have some input into whether we enter into the Vietnam agreement?
Yeah, I really I am holding a series of seminars with Chinese nuclear experts. I'm actually flying some in mm-hmm. the end of this month. That topic has not come up. We'll make sure it does. But that said, I think the Chinese are sensitive to what's going on in the region, and I think that they assume for the moment that Vietnam isn't a problem, but in the long run, they are at odds. They are at odds, and they would be concerned. And so I think most important, the Chinese have come on record saying they're very concerned about what Japan might do in reprocessing. Mm-hmm. By the way, that is an agreement that is in perpetuity that should have been renegotiated for 2018. No one is pushing for that. I think you should. And the reason why is to force a debate in Japan, not so much here, about what Japan ought to be doing. Because if they open up that plant, that's going to be a hornet's nest in the Far East, in China, South Korea, God knows where else. And so we have a stake in seeing them at least have a public debate about that. We have shut that down by having an agreement.
One final comment. I noticed that the Vietnam agreement says that they intend to rely on international suppliers for fuels. Every year I issue a statement indicating that I intend to lose weight.
Me too.
I yield back.
Thank you. Judge Poe from Texas is recognized.
Well, don't issue that statement each year.
Thank you, Madam Chair. There's the issue of human rights. I want to hear from each one of you. Do you think the issue of human rights is something we should even be talking about in this 123 agreement, or is that a separate issue that the United States needs to deal with not just Vietnam, but other countries? Mr. Selinsky, start with you, then Mr. Lippman.
My nonprofit stuck its neck out to really raise fundamental questions about the North Korean nuclear cooperative agreement that we entered into. It was called the Agreed Framework. It wasn't a 123. It was technically and from a security standpoint very, very odd. All through that effort, and I think as many opportunities as I could, I also raised the question of human rights. Because ultimately, contracts, and you want ironclad contracts with this kind of technology, has to do with trust. So the idea that you would separate the way the government abuses or treats its own citizen, because it has a trust with its own citizenry, that you would separate that from something so important as an agreement on this kind of sensitive technology did not make sense to me. And so I think they're linked, and I think we're seeing this clearly in the case of Iran, and we're seeing it at various levels with our dealings, even on the chemical issue, with Syria.
All right, Mr. Lippman.
It's gotta be part of the mix.
Mr. Lippman.
Judge, certainly Congress should raise this issue if it's of concern, as it should be to all Americans who share the values of this country. However, it has no part in a 123 agreement, in our opinion. What we push for is engagement across industries generally, and of course the nuclear industry in particular, as a way of promulgating American values with countries in which we interact, but they should not be linked. One should not be conditioned on the other, Judge.
Okay, Mr. Spector.
I think I would take into account a fairly wide range of issues. Certainly in a cover memorandum that's accompanying a document like this, and you know that there must have been one like it that circulated in the administration, all of the major elements of our relationship with Vietnam need to be taken into account, not in the text of the agreement, but in the context of whether we want to go forward with this. And I'd say the elements, there are certain elements that cross over. One is rule of law. Another is independence of enforcement personnel and regulators. That's not quite as vivid or as visceral as the human rights problem. But I think you want to look at the full spectrum. And of course, we need to look at our relationship with Vietnam vis-a-vis China, which is another sort of underlying national security concern. So I think you don't want to limit this too precisely. I think a lot of these issues need to be weighed in the balance.
All right, thank you. Let me talk about term limits. I didn't mean to startle my colleagues here. Not term limits for members of Congress, but for contracts. Do you think there should be a term limit for these contracts? Should there be no end in sight? Should we make it 30 years, 50 years? Should we solidify the deal for a time certain? Just kind of a yes or no, and how long?
This goes to your human rights question. If you distrust, you need to do more verification, therefore you want more frequent renegotiation. If you trust, you need less.
All right. Mr. Lippman?
Judge, the industry has no quarrel with a 30-year limitation. What we do want, though, is predictability. We want these agreements, the negotiation of these agreements, to begin early and not to be in a situation where we're up against the gun, either in competitive space or because an agreement is ready to run out. The term to us is to some degree, immaterial.
Mr. Spector.
I would stick with the 30-year limit as well. I think you do want things, agreements to come back before Congress. You do want the automatic opportunity to upgrade the agreements. At the same time, you need to give some certainty over a fairly long period to the industry, because these plants take 10 years to build and will operate for 30 to 50 years. So you have to find a balance in there. But I think these automatic extensions are not the way to go.
All right. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you. Thank you, Judge Poe. Dr. Baer is recognized.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. I want to revisit an issue that my colleague from California, Mr. Sherman, brought up, the Indian civil nuclear deal that was negotiated and signed in 2008. Obviously, it hasn't, you know, transpired the way we certainly would have liked to for a variety of issues, but particularly the liability issue, which seems to be unique to India. And, you know, and it's not just our companies that are somewhat reluctant, GE and Westinghouse, but certainly the French and Russian companies that have, you know, much better protections. You know, our industries are private and certainly would get exposed. With a new administration coming into India, with Prime Minister Modi certainly making overtures to want to increase trade, wanting to build India's infrastructure and expand its economy, and you know, I think within the past month, you know, there's been some movement in terms of signing agreements with the IAEA. I'd be curious on a couple things. Maybe Mr. Lipman, you could answer this. How large is the Indian market, and what next steps with the Prime Minister visiting Washington D.C. in September would you like to see for us to really open up the market and partner?
Thank you, Dr. Baer. First of all, I can say categorically that to U.S. Reactor vendors and EPC organizations like Bechtel and Fluor and so forth, India is a top market prospect. I mean, this is a country that has significant technical talent that can very outstanding backgrounds in structural engineering and heavy manufacturing that complement the U.S. Industry very, very well. I will say, in terms of positive developments, and I know there's been some, I guess in earlier remarks, disappointment, I might say, that somehow the India market hasn't materialized after the very important political hoops that this country has had to, and this branch has had to jump through in order to make it a reality. These are long-term deals. They take a long time to negotiate, okay? But both reactor vendors either have now or are in the last stages of negotiating early works agreement. So what's that mean? That's the engineering and technical work that goes on before reactor sales consummate. However, to your point, Dr. Baer, there will not be nuclear deals in India unless and until the civil nuclear liability issue is resolved. And I think like you, Dr. Baer, am heartened that the Modi administration is beginning to come to terms with reform of liability. That would make, and that would truly open up that market to U.S. reactor vendors in a big way. Thank you, sir.
Great. You know, Mr. Selinsky, you know, as we're moving, are there any concerns that India has not signed the non-proliferation treaty, and you know, as we move forward and partner with the marketplace?
The Iranians love that deal. They bring it up when they negotiate. The South Koreans carp about it. It's a thorn in the side of anyone trying to prevent proliferation. You better get something for it. We haven't. Now, we were talking about reactors back in 2005. I think the liability problems, given Bhopal and the history, and an emerging public cry for both less corruption with big contracts and concern about public safety, it's a long bet. I don't know that it's a bet against the House, but I would be looking for other ways to promote trade and engagement with India and the new government. I would not lean heavily on this. And that has always been the case. And there are many areas that make more sense to focus on.
You're bringing it back to Mr. Lipman. How large is the Indian market?
Their plans are to put out up to 50 nuclear reactors over the coming 30 years. That's a plan. But there are currently agreements in place and reactor deals that have been consummated with the Russians. At Kundukulam, there are operating reactors of Russian design, and there is a new set of units that have just been consummated with the Russians. Plus, as was mentioned earlier, the French are in there. We need this civil nuclear liability protection. I'm certain that American companies just will not put their companies at risk. And what's interesting, it's not just American companies that get hurt. My view is so do Indian companies get hurt. Now, why is that? I think there are many American companies that would like to leverage the fact that there are English-speaking, highly technically trained, very capable engineers and manufacturers in the country of India. But they're not going to partner with them until this liability issue is put behind us. So to me, India represents, in some ways, and I disagree with Henry on this, that India represents a phenomenal partnership opportunity for American nuclear companies.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Dr. Barra. And now we turn to one of our subcommittee chairs, Mr. Rohrbacher of California.
Thank you very much, Madam Chairman, and I appreciate the leadership that you and Chairman Royce have exemplified, especially by this hearing. I have some deep concerns about what I've heard today, and it doesn't necessarily come from you, but it comes from the fact that I am also vice chairman of the science committee, and I've spent a lot of time dealing with nuclear reactors and the technological aspect of this discussion. Mr. Lippman, we're rushing to 172 reactors, we say, are perhaps on the way to being built. Are any of them non-light water reactors? Light water reactors are 50 and 60-year-old technology, and they are dangerous, as we've seen in Japan. Do we not now have the capability to build safe reactors, whether they're, I guess, thorium-based, they've got small modular nuclear reactors, pebble-based reactors, high-temperature gas-cooled reactors, all of which do not have this same potential of creating a disaster? Am I wrong? Is this other information I'm getting in the Science Committee that we're being fed that we're capable of building a better reactor that's not such a danger?
Chairman, I certainly don't share your view on that. First, almost all of the plants that are planned for construction indeed are light water reactors.
Right.
The other technologies that you accurately represented are technologies that simply aren't commercially available today.
They aren't available today because your industry is not invested in it. We have had a disaster in Japan, and how much more has your industry then decided to put into development of some of these alternatives that we have that would have made, that had Japan had those technologies, they wouldn't be facing this radioactive crisis that they're in?
So with respect, Chairman, it is our industry that is investing in these new technologies. B&W and NuScale and Westinghouse are developing small modular reactors. TerraPower in Seattle is investing in the traveling wave reactor, which I think you're referring
and
to.
By the way, we're not.
So those technologies, sir, are in the offing. And with respect to the Fukushima accident, which you appropriately represent, one need only look at the reactors for sale on the international market from American vendors right now, GE and Westinghouse. They're designed for exactly that type of accident.
Well, let me just note that for less than $2 billion investment, we could have one of those other type of reactors on the market. We could have invested it, had we invested in that 20 years ago or 15 years ago when these reactors were possible. And had we had a pebble-based reactor system in Japan, there wouldn't be a nuclear crisis there right now. I mean, I realize that people think that our industry has done. I am not anti-nuclear, as you can see. I mean, I want us to build nuclear reactors, but we have not kept up. The industry has basically been willing to sell old technology rather than invest in what is necessary to build these things. For example, we have high-temperature gas-cooled reactors that it would be impossible then for there to be the type of leak that we have in Japan under the same circumstances. This is very disturbing, and also let me ask this, Mr. Lippman, and again, I'm pro-nuclear reactor. I think that nuclear energy offers a great alternative, but aren't we also talking about these new reactors? Had we invested in them, this idea of reprocessing wouldn't even be on the table. It's my understanding that there's not plutonium left over from these new reactors. We haven't invested in something that would be safer and would not leave a plutonium threat of having nuclear weapons being made from the byproduct. I will just have to say that as much as I respect the development of the technology in your industry, I think that your industry has been, along with our government, been irresponsible in not putting the money into the development of safer reactors that would leave the world safer from nuclear weapons as well as nuclear leaks.
Thank you so much, Mr. Rohrabacher. And I'm pleased to recognize Mr. Connolly, and thanks for sharing that personal biographical fact with me. Did not know that.
I knew you'd want to know. So thank you, Madam Chairman. By the way, Mr. Sikorsky, to my friend from California's point about the need to invest in new technologies and the fact that by not having done so in a timely manner, perhaps unwittingly, we're actually expanding the proliferation threat. Would you agree with that?
There is a firm actually in your district, I think, or near, Lyndon Blue, is someone I regularly meet with. Yeah. On paper, they have some wonderful things. By the way, that's General Atomics, and they actually don't need Price Anderson, they say, if they could ever get going. I think the problem, oddly, is that the firms we keep talking about as American, Westinghouse, by the way, do you know who owns Westinghouse nuclear? Mostly? 77%? Foreign countries, mostly Japan. I mean, these are not your average American companies. They don't manufacture. That manufacturing is done overseas for the key nuclear qualified components. This is to a lesser extent, but still significantly true of General Electric. So the innovation you're talking about is for a multinational corporate entity that's largely Korean, Japanese, American, but American last. So, you know, you're going to have to work this by talking with these other countries, not just American firms, because they own most of these.
Okay,
companies.
But the point is, if Mr. Rohrabacher is correct, that there are promising new technologies that actually eliminate the problem of what to do with plutonium or what you can do with plutonium.
Reduce it.
Or reduce, well, I think he actually
eliminate the, you know, it's the sales pitch.
Okay.
But reduce it.
But surely, if such technology were commercially available, wouldn't the United States want to promote it?
You know,
Mr. Lippman is shaking his head for the record, yes.
How shall I put it? Everyone wants to promote different forms of energy. They just don't want to pay for it.
Okay.
You know, by the way, my favorite is power from moonbeams, but it's very expensive. And so the point here is you want to leverage R&D to find out if something works and let the people who go to banks figure out if they can make a buck using the technology. And the market has spoken. A lot of these reactors, and the reason they're sticking with the light water reactor, is that they don't want to take any additional risks, and they'd rather stick with the risks they know than the risks they don't know.
Good, fair point. All right, Mr. Spector, The chairman, my friend from Florida, Ileana Ross-Layton, said she's sponsoring a bill with Brad Sherman, and the premise of that bill is we shouldn't differentiate. We need one uniform gold standard, and we should be strict about it and enforce it in all 123 agreements for everybody. If I heard your testimony correctly, that's not exactly your point of view.
I would say the testimony has to deal with an actual agreement that's in front of us. And I would say when you took all the factors into account, you'd say this agreement is one we can live with. But what do we want to do going forward? And there, I think, it is time to adopt a tougher standard. And as I may have said earlier,
But the point here isn't just a tough standard. It is one standard that is tough, but one for all. That's what the chairman's point was.
I think I was supporting that going forward.
Okay.
But we have to deal with this particular agreement in front of us, which will come into effect in another 90 days or whatever it may be. And I would say there, you don't want to reject the agreement and start from scratch and go through a very traumatic situation. I think we can tolerate this one.
Well, two more questions real quickly because my time is running out because Mr. Sokolowski was calling down moonbeam power. Again, the chairman pointed out Vietnam is under this agreement is allowed to enrich. Why? And second question, doesn't that undermine policies elsewhere, especially in the Middle East, where we don't want them doing that?
Well, I think you are correct that the possibility was reserved by the Vietnamese, but they did step forward and attempt to contain that and spoke about their plan not to do so and their plan to rely exclusively on outside sources of fuel and services. I agree that is not an ironclad guarantee, and it's made worse in this agreement because of the fact that the agreement won't automatically terminate and have to be renewed. It's going to be renewed automatically. So I would not speak with enthusiasm about this agreement. I would speak as tolerable, barely getting over the...
The second question, though, Mr. Spector, was, but doesn't it, not intentionally, couldn't it contribute to undermining policy elsewhere? That's
absolutely
the chairman's point.
I mean, that I completely
agree.
Thank
you very much, Mr. Connolly, but we are out of time, and we will turn to one of our subcommittee chairs, Mr. Chabot of Ohio.
Thank you, Madam Chair. And these so-called 123 agreements are an important tool for advancing U.S. nonproliferation policy and for impeding the spread of uranium enrichment capabilities and fuel reprocessing around the world. Last year, the Asia subcommittee that I chair held a joint hearing to examine the extension of the 123 agreement with South Korea. And I strongly support the extension of the ongoing agreement and support its renewal because it not only provides our regional ally, South Korea, with a domestic supply of energy, but it also creates American jobs in those sectors that supply South Korea with the components it needs to maintain the power supply for its economy. A couple of questions. First, how much importance does the government of the Republic of Korea assign to the successful renewal of the 123 agreement? And then second, what are the risks if the U.S. and South Korea are unable to reach an acceptable outcome regarding the renewal of this agreement? And do you have a sense of the impact that there could be if we were unable to reach an agreement on the U.S. nuclear industry? Mr. Lippman?
Thank you, Mr. Chabot. I'll limit my answer to the industrial impacts of what you discussed. You talked about the job creation associated with nuclear power generally, mm-hmm. but very specifically with the Republic of Korea. Mm-hmm. American companies partner with the Koreans in other markets. There are deals where American companies are in the lead and the Koreans are subcontractors, but there are deals such as the one in the United Arab Emirates where the Koreans are in the lead and there's significant job creation. And these 123 agreements are critical. That is why American unions in particular are very supportive of 123 agreements because their membership receives significant benefit from the export. The Koreans utilize American technology, older American technology. And so having the export controls survive and be applied into markets in which the Koreans wish to operate is something that's very important. And so the 123 agreement is important to us in the industry, not just for industrial cooperation and job creation, but also for the continued exercise of control over U.S. technology as the Koreans go into other markets. So we support the timely completion during this two-year extension period. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Lippman, let me follow up on a different country here. Regarding the U.S.-China 123 agreement, which expires next year, I believe, you briefly discussed the importance of renewing this agreement, both for the U.S. exports and American jobs. And I was wondering if you or any of the other fellow panelists could discuss the risks associated with a U.S.-China nuclear cooperation agreement with regard to the theft of foreign technology and China's relationships with, for example, Pakistan, North Korea, and Iran. And I'll start with you, Mr. Lippman. And I've got 1 minute and 20 seconds for all three of you. So,
well, so if you have that little time, I'd say the risk is in not renewing the agreement, because you want this agreement, you want those proliferation controls in place, you want those industrial relationships in place, and you want the continued ability to have eyes on the Chinese nuclear program and also to reap any economic benefits that come from it. Thank you.
I think we are leveraged there because they are having trouble getting these machines built properly according to the French, and I suspect in the U.S. case too. But more important, the know-how is something they bought. They own enough of the design now that they're working with Westinghouse and our Department of Energy to build these things not only there, but to export them. So the business model is a little bit more than the U.S. in the case of Westinghouse. They're playing both ends of the game. Okay. So I would sort of be worried about corruption and what could be sold to other countries. They are under investigation in China. The leaders of the nuclear industry are indicted for corruption. We don't know what they might sell.
Thank you. I note my time has expired. Madam Chair,
thank
we have
you so much. We will
15 seconds.
We will allow him to respond, Mr. Spector.
I would say if you go back to the history of the U.S.-China agreement, it turned on exports from China that we were not happy with. These are missiles to Pakistan and a lot of other undesirable exports. They are continuing, not precisely the same ones, but Iran has been a beneficiary of much technology that's come through China and its missile program and also its nuclear program. There's a $5 million bounty on a Chinese businessman, Carl Lee, because of these activities. So I believe this is going to be a major issue when their agreement comes up for renewal.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chabot. Mr. Lowenthal.
Thank you, Madam Chair. And I want to follow up on an issue that you originally raised, and I think Congressman Poe touched on. And I would really like if anybody on the panel can kind of allay my concerns at this moment. There are more concerns than there are a question. I've heard, and I think what's in the agreement, that it is not the ideal, it is not the standard potentially that many members would want, and I understand that. And I'm hearing in general from the panel, it still makes sense, though, to move forward, even though it may not be the gold standard, or at least the consensus I'm hearing. But I'm also concerned, as what I said before, what's not in the agreement, what's outside the agreement, and that is, you know, Vietnam has one of the worst records of human rights violations in all of Southeast Asia and possibly in the world. And, you know, here and even on yesterday we had a hearing, I've spoken out against the Vietnam's inclusion in the Trans-Pacific Partnership until they improve their human rights record, until they demonstrate that they are a country that values the ability of people to engage in activities, to come together, to worship as they so choose, to not to be imprisoned. And yet, is this not the same issue? What can we do? We've already had this agreement. We know that Vietnam is a terrible violator of human rights. We're now asked to support or not to support the agreement that's been negotiated. And yet I have these real concerns that we are now rewarding again bad behavior.
I think you have a bit more of a choice. You know, ultimately, the barriers to blocking a deal are just almost insurmountable. You need two-thirds votes in both houses. But if you should demand that this thing be delayed until certain things were taken care of, I have every confidence that they would delay it. And the reason why is there is no reason to rush. The talks industry needs to have are not going to be held up because they don't have a 123 in place. They will talk if they think it's coming. And they have plenty of time to talk because they're not even building their first new reactor for another 6 years. We have done this in the case of the UAE deal, the Russian deal. We did it actually just recently with a South Korean deal. I certainly share your puzzlement as to why you wouldn't ask for this. You might be told, forget it, but not to ask? That seems odd. By the way, I'm the one of the people that thinks you shouldn't go ahead with this deal. Maybe the others are okay with it. I'm not okay with it. I side with Ms. Ross Leighton on this.
Is there any way, you know, once we go forward, we have no leverage any longer. Is there any leverage we have? I'm not saying put it in the deal, you're saying, but as a precondition. What leverage do we have?
So, I mean, one tool that's available, it takes legislation, is to put a freeze on licensing so that the agreement sits in place, but nothing can travel under it, and it can't be implemented. This was done with China. And I think they were on hold for quite a number of years because of the exports I mentioned earlier. It's not elegant, and it's not easy to do, but it is a tool that's available. And there are vehicles that have been used by the Congress to advance certain goals in the nonproliferation area. This is a related area, such as various must-have legislation where riders are put on or amendments or what have you. And so there are some tools available if the depth of concern is widespread.
Thank you, and I yield back.
Thank you so much, Mr. Lowenthal, and we will turn to Mr. Kinzinger.
Thank you, Madam Chair, and I appreciate the committee holding this hearing and for all of you being here. Mr. Sikorski, I want to remind you at the very beginning here, you've made a couple of shots at Westinghouse. I'm not going to give you an opportunity to respond, but I'd like to remind you that that is an American company, and they have a lot of employees in Pennsylvania. And in my district, there's a lot of companies that supply Westinghouse. So whatever the beef you have seems to be with them, you can expound at a later time. But I just wanted to remind you that that is an American company. In terms of in terms of a couple of opening points, let me just say I think we need to move forward with the U.S.-Vietnam 123 agreement. Ranking Member Angle and I have signaled our support for that. And I'd also like to express my support for the U.S.-South Korea 123 agreement. For 60 years, this has been one of our greatest allies in a very important part of the world. And the Republic of Korea, in fact, has brought a lot of stability to the world, security and prosperity. I'm going to have the opportunity to visit Korea in a few months and talk about these issues, and I'm looking forward to it. But I would like to say that that's something that's very important to move forward on. And it's also interesting to me that the sticking point, you know, the issue of enriching and reprocessing and things along that line, we are basically giving that to Iran, by the way. I've had discussions with folks in the administration, none of whom have said that there is going to be no right to enrich any kind of uranium up to a certain level. So it's almost a given now that our greatest enemy in the Middle East, of which we actually have engaged directly and indirectly with through Iraq and everywhere else, is going to have this right that we're denying to our allies. And so that, to me, is something that's going to be very shocking and something telling and something I think we need to have a real grown-up adult discussion on. Mr. Lipman, I'm going to shift gears a little bit here and ask you a couple of questions. Is the U.S. still the dominant player in the nuclear export market? If so, why? And if not, why?
Thank you, Congressman. And thank you also for straightening out the facts that Westinghouse is an American company. And I can assure you that in these nuclear exports, the overwhelming majority, the vast amount of value in these nuclear exports is made right here in the USA, in states like South Carolina, Pennsylvania, New Hampshire, and so forth. So thank you for clearing that up. I mentioned earlier we are certainly not the dominant player. There are, I mentioned earlier, about 10 nuclear reactor vendors globally. That is a situation that has transpired in the last, just the last few years, and it's extremely competitive out there. Where we do not have these agreements in place, competitors will fill that void. Of that, there is no question. Now, why is that? Your question is, well, why is that? Well, some of them are state-owned enterprises. So the government of Russia owns Rosatom, which in turn owns Atomstroy Export, which is the main competitor American companies face from Russia. Areva is wholly owned by the French government. Korea Electric Power Company is similarly owned by the Korean government, and so forth and so on. Even Canada is a crown corporation. U.S. industry is private, largely, and somewhat fragmented. Also, the level of commercial diplomacy is quite different, Congressman. It is very typical that when heads of state of these other countries travel, in their entourage are the nuclear guys and the radar guys and the defense guys and so forth and so on. That we don't do business that way, and that's okay. That's not our way, and I don't think anybody in the industry would change that. But we're finding now a very tough competitive environment, and one in which the Russians, for example, offer to take your spent fuel back. We don't do that. They offer extremely concessionary finance. We may not get our Ex-Im Bank financed.
Right.
Thirdly, there are significant trade advocacy that we don't receive. So it is a tough environment out there. We're not asking to have our hands held, but we're asking for a competitive level playing field so we can do business, Congressman.
I think you made a great point about Ex-Im. It's very important for multiple reasons, and I think that's something that is very important. I have four nuclear power plants in my district, and I'd frankly hate to get to a point where we have Russians and French coming in and servicing them because we lost our own industry. And just lastly, in, 8 seconds, how important are foreign markets to the U.S. nuclear industry?
They are more important than ever before, and they are in markets that are non-traditional. They're in places like, and we'd better get comfortable with places like, Southeast Asia, South Asia, Eastern Europe. We haven't talked about Eastern Europe, but Eastern Europeans are keen to get away from the Russians and their grip on gas, and in places in the Middle East. So we are in a situation in which we compete in non-traditional markets against state-owned enterprises, and the need for trade finance and advocacy and a level playing field is greater than ever before. Thank you, Congressman.
And I yield back my lack of time.
Thank you, gentlemen. Time has expired. The gentleman from Texas, Mr. Weber, is recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Lipman, I think you said that there are 10 global companies that supply reactors, build and supply reactors. What would you say is the overall world marketplace for the amount of volume of sales? Is it 200 billion? Is it, what is it?
I want to say the number that sticks in my mind is about 750 billion or so.
750 billion. Do you know what percent mostly U.S. manufacturers, and I guess including Westinghouse, what percent of that market share U.S. manufacturers own?
So let's break it down a little bit. So there's new reactor sales, but there's also plenty of sales of nuclear fuel and services and spare parts and things like that.
And I'm talking total. Thank you for making that distinction.
Yes, sir. And so I would say that in the fuel market, maybe we have 10 to 15% of that market. And I think in the new reactor market, it's looking a lot better. And it will look better if we get these 123s and other policy tools that I mentioned earlier in place. We have a much better chance at major reactor sales, I think, than the competitive situation would warrant. But I'll get those details and submit to the record the accurate figure, sir.
Any idea how many jobs that represents in this country?
Yeah. So by the way, NEI is undertaking an effort to count them. Down to the district level if we can, down to the zip code if we can. But we know from the China...
Well, send me the numbers from my district, will you?
Yes, sir. We know from the China export that somewhere between 15 and 18,000 jobs were created or maintained from just that one export of 4 units, sir.
Okay. And I'm not a nuclear... expert. When I was a state rep, I had a nuclear plant, South Texas nuclear plant in Bay City in my district, and got to tour it and watch it firsthand, look at it firsthand. Why is reprocessing of spent fuel such a bad thing? Is it just because it leaves material laying around for weapons? Is that your only concern?
Well, I'll answer, and I'll certainly defer to the experts here. And by the way, I lived in Brazoria County for 5 years, so I'm...
Well, we're still taking applications if you want to come back.
Thank you, sir. It was a great place to live. Look, you said it. Reprocessing makes available plutonium. Separated can make available, depending on the process, separated plutonium, which can be diverted for inappropriate uses, and that's a major concern.
Okay, thank you. And that's what I thought. Mr. Spector, you talked about an export agreement or an agreement delaying licensing, which wasn't elegant. There was a way to do it. And I think you mentioned that it was discovered that China was going to export missiles. And so that was, we held up an agreement. Can you go back to that?
Well, I've got to get my dates right. My recollection was that an agreement was inked, and we were ready to go forward with it as they gradually accepted more and more export control rules, such as agreeing to the export control rules of the missile technology control regime in particular, but other ones as well.
Okay, well, let me...
And then, because they didn't stop the actual exports, the agreement was intact, but it wasn't... Nothing happened under it.
Let me play the devil's advocate here. Why was it a problem for China to export missiles?
Well,
missile technology.
I think in the particular case, we were very concerned that these missiles would be armed with nuclear weapons. This was going to Pakistan, especially. Since that time, the missiles have gone to Iran, a lot of missile equipment. This is a sort of continuing problem.
So we're concerned that those missiles would be used to destroy civilians, hit cities, and used in a very aggressive military fashion.
Conceivably. Kill
people.
It's contrary to our efforts to suppress this kind of capability around the world.
But you said that you didn't think that human rights violations needed to be part of the agreement. So we're concerned that missiles would kill hundreds or thousands of people, but we're not concerned if they're killing individuals.
I think I actually said something a little different, which was in the four corners of the agreement, the actual wording, probably not missiles or human rights.
Maybe a preclusion leading up to that.
That is correct. Or a freezing of the negotiation. This is what happened with the United Arab Emirates agreement when concerns about leakage of technology through Dubai into Iran surfaced. And Congress actually was responsible for sort of changing the terms of that agreement.
The gentleman's time has expired.
Thank you, Chairman.
Thank you. The gentleman from Florida, Mr. Yoho, is recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I appreciate you gentlemen being here, and I look forward to your answers on this, and the information you've already given has been great. Mr. Sokolsky, you were saying that by not going forward, you would not go forward with the 123 agreement with Vietnam. What would you recommend in replacement of that?
I would be in no rush to get it wrong. Take your time if you're going to get it wrong. You should pressure the administration to at least give you the procedural authority to look at this thing in 30 years.
I agree.
I wouldn't I mean, that much at least. I think you're going to have some fancy footwork here to persuade the South Koreans if you go ahead with this thing, but maybe this committee can do it. We have an able chairman of a subcommittee, and that's going to require doubling down on that and perhaps delaying the Iran deal.
Well, for a superpower, we need to act like one, and I think we need to negotiate harder. The 1-2-3 agreement I see, they seem messy, and for a country like South Korea, that's an ally, in the beginning of the agreement, it looks like it worked well. But now they're giving us pushback because they have an excessive amount of plutonium that they say, we need the capability of reprocessing this. You guys aren't helping us, and so there's resistance, so we had to do the two-year extension because we couldn't come into an agreement. And then we look at what's going on with China. We had the agreement, but however, it says China's proliferation record is very poor, including building nuclear reactors in Pakistan, refusing to curb illegal sales, as you brought up, and smuggling Chinese companies of by Chinese companies of banned nuclear-related material to Iran and other countries. You know, we get involved in these complicated agreements, and what I have seen is there's just no checks and balances to monitor them, but it makes us feel good because we can say we've had a 1-2-3 agreement. You know, we're great. But in the meantime, sleight of hand, they're doing this. And I guess what I'd like in the two, almost 3 minutes I have left, how can we make, or first of all, should we enter these kind of agreements, especially if we're not the major player? And we're competing against government entities, state-owned and operated. And what I understand about China is when they come in, it's not a Chinese company. It's the Chinese government, it's their military, it's their secret service. It's all that as a package. You get the package. And so that concerns me because we're having companies like Westinghouse dealing as a company with foreign governments. So you're on, I mean, you just can't compete that way. So how can we move forward? Number one, should we move forward with this kind of an agreement? And if we do, how do we make a 1-2-3 type of agreement more workable to accomplish the goal of eliminating the amount of spent fuel that's reprocessed in nuclear proliferation? We'll start with you, Mr. Sokolsky.
I think the simple thing is to demand more of our diplomats and to lean more heavily on the handful of suppliers. There may be lots of companies, but there are only a few countries. We know who they are. They're France, Korea, Japan, and Russia. China coming up. There are leverage points. I've talked with people who in the government say, well, we haven't asked, or if we asked, we didn't make any linkage to anything that they might be concerned about. You gotta change that.
All right, Mr. Lippman, because I got one more question I wanna.
You did an accurate job characterizing, I think, the environment in which we face. But you were being very future-oriented here, and I would say one of the biggest tools, you talked about eliminating the amount or reducing the amount of fuel that could be diverted or reprocessed and the material diverted. One thing we don't do, which we could do, is take spent fuel back into this country. That would
and
be an extreme.
And we've got the technology to reuse that. It's just not been approved, or we haven't allowed that, right?
Well, right now, we do not allow by law the take back of spent fuel for fuel we sell to other countries.
But we can reprocess as energy, right?
We don't have commercial reprocessing in this country, but okay. We have the technology that could do it.
I'm running out of time. Mr. Spector, I want you to get your way in on that.
Well, I think when Henry made the point that we have other leverage with these various countries, that's what you would use as during the course of these agreements. It can be economic sanctions or export controls that are, you know, licenses that are held back and so forth. The agreement, you know, carries on, but you can apply leverage in a lot of different ways to try to make sure it's properly adhered to.
And what I see is with the debacle with what we did with Iran, a future country to negotiate with us on a 1-2-3 agreement, after what they saw us do with Iran, they're going to say, we want the same deal you gave Iran, and I think it's crippled us tremendously. I yield back. Thank you.
Thank you. Gentleman's time has expired. The gentleman from Pennsylvania, Mr. Perry, is recognized for 5 minutes.
Thanks, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Lippman, I'll start with you. Regarding China's nuclear industry, and we expect it to expand a reasonable amount over the next few decades. I'm just wondering about the opportunities it'll create for the U.S. nuclear industry, and because we want to we want to build as much and do as much as we can in our districts and in the United States. It's a business that's important to us. But are we creating a competitor by undercutting ourselves by providing it with nuclear? What are we looking for, and what's the middle ground there?
Right, and that's a very critical competitive issue that any company that wants to do business in China needs to face. When I had to face that decision at the time I ran the new reactors business for Westinghouse, the solution to that is you sell the technology, but you have to continue to innovate. If you do not innovate, you will create another competitor. I mean, you are creating another competitor, but the key to maintaining leadership is to continue to out-innovate your partners, number one. Number two, with respect to having a relationship with the Chinese nuclear industry, they're smart folks. They've got technology that's of interest to us too in civilian space, okay, so in the civilian area. So we learn from each other. Reactors under construction today in America are benefiting from lessons learned from reactor construction in China. It's happening right now in Georgia and South Carolina. So these are relationships that are important. They're job creating. They support all kinds of political objectives, and working together is the solution, in my opinion, Congressman.
All right, so moving on then, and I want to get some of the other gentlemen in the discussion with the 123 agreement expiring in 2015, other than spent fuel situation, which apparently needs to be addressed, at least allowing us the opportunity to do something, not making a prohibition and not saying we have to do something, but what else needs to be changed or to increase our opportunities and our security in that regard from your standpoint? And then Mr. Spector and Mr. Sikorsky, it'd be great to hear from you on that as well.
So I'm clear, Congressman, increase opportunities for?
U.S. companies.
For U.S.
Westinghouse, there's a company in the in the district I represent which builds casks.
Yeah.
So those kind of folks.
Yeah, okay. Listen, I mentioned in my opening statement a number of policy solutions. I think having 123 agreements in place, I think having an export control process that works, I think liability protection is important, export-import finance is important, and a generally a pro-nuclear trade policy. Those will create opportunities where American companies can thrive against this very tough international competition in this basically international market now.
I would say at the moment, the closest related area of concern has to do with exports from China and their inability to suppress certain individuals from engaging in these activities. This is going to North Korea and going to Iran. That has to be on the table as we discuss this renewal of an agreement, because it's a very closely related area. But there are other issues. There are human rights issues in China. There's plenty on the table. And the question, I think, is to decide how much of that we want to bring into the conversation, and which ones we hold for another occasion.
So without reaching too far, I would agree with you to a certain extent, but if we can't get to human rights issues with China, but we can get to reining them in with some of their proliferation around the other rogue nations, so to speak, maybe that's more important if that's what we can get out of the deal. And in my opinion, maybe that's what we should focus on. But
there may be other higher level discussions where you want to bring the human rights issue up, where you'll have more impact.
I think you've got to focus on safety, because what you've done is, just as we saw Westinghouse sell all of its designs to France and created a French competitor, they are doing it now with regard to China. I really urge the committee to get more knowledgeable and hold some hearings on exactly what the difference between technology transfers and how important that is to the industry. And if you go to their website, they talk about technology transfers. That is not controlled by 123 agreements. The amount of things that we sell manufactured here for these projects is not very great. The leverage has to do with the know-how. And I think if you want to get the maximum amount of engagement in their industry, you better press hard on being more candid about the safety problems in China.
Gentlemen,
thanks, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. on behalf of the chairman of the committee, we'd like to thank the panel for their very helpful testimony here this morning. Members will have 5 days to revise statements or submit written questions. And if there's no further business to come before the committee, we're adjourned. Thank you.